Here I will be talking mostly only with about the Hydrus codes. It's 1D, 2D, 3D, but the exercises this later today and in the week we're going to focus only on the 1D. There is no really time to also do 3D. Again, 1D is in the public domain, so you can download it freely. And So the focus again is basically the unsaturated zone together with the connections to the atmosphere. So think about evapotranspiration, root water uptake, and so on. And of course, the interaction with the groundwater. So it can be, the codes can actually be used also for saturated flow. And the building blocks I mentioned yesterday, I'm not going to give a whole lot of equations. The focus really is on the processes in the equations. I'm also not going to talk about numerics. We spent a lot of time doing the best we can with numerics, and I'm sure over the years it can still be improved, but that's not our major concern, and certainly not here. So we're going to talk a bit about the unsaturated or variably saturated flow equation, solute transport, and then also we have the building blocks for heat movement in 1, 2, 3D. We have some sources and sinks and so on. I'll mention that during the talk. Yeah. So I mentioned agricultural applications. So again, this is really my background. I worked for it's called the Agricultural Research Service. So that was actually a federal laboratory in California. So we had a lot of problems there with salinity. But we also looked at nutrients. Think about fertilizers, and then also pesticides. Fumigants was a big issue. Colloids now, we think about dairy farms and all that good stuff or bad stuff they produce. Yeah. And then industrial applications and environmental applications. So these are basically the processes. So what I want to do now is slowly go through these. We have about 50 minutes. And these are the processes that are built in, so we're going to actually work with several of them in the practical course. So let's start with the variably saturated flow. We call it the Richards equation. And I'll mention, let me do that first. This is actually L.A. Richards. He did this, he formulated this equation in 1931. He actually worked also at that laboratory where I was, the salinity lab. So he's quite a famous person there. I still met him actually when I started quite a few years ago. So Jesus Carrera talked about Darcy's law, where you have the, in his case, this was a small h, the head, but it is the pressure head and the gravitational head in our case. For saturated flow, of course, we have a saturated hydraulic conductivity. For unsaturated flow, we generally call that the Buckingham-Darcy equation or Darcy-Buckingham law. But there, the hydraulic conductivity becomes a function of basically saturation or the pressure head in this case. And then again, we have the pressure head. So that's capillary pressure divided by rho g, as Jesus was talking about. And then the gravitational head. So this is the flux equation. Then we combine that with a mass balance equation, continuity equation. So that says, you know, whatever comes into this room and goes out, the difference is really changing the water content as a function of time in the room. So, and you combine that. So this is the Richards equation. It's a mixed form in the sense that this is a function, the water content, and here the pressure head. So it's a mixed form, but this turns out to be the best way of solving it, where we really do a finite difference, finite element approach for solving, and then way at the end we go also to the pressure head for the time derivative. But I'm not going to further talk about that. The main challenges of these equations are these constitutive relationships. I'm going to call it the hydraulic properties, the unsaturated hydraulic properties. So this will be, I'm going to call that later the water retention function and the hydraulic conductivity function. Yeah. So this is in 1D, in 2, 3D, this is, you know, tensorial notation, I and J goes from 1, 2, 3. Yeah. So these constitutive relationship, I'm going to call it the soil water retention function. But you know, this is the PCS curve, a capillary pressure saturation. If you plot that versus relative saturation, I like to work with water content because I can see better, you know, also heterogeneity much easier than if you plot it versus relative saturation. Typical curves here for fine textured, medium textured, think about clay, think about a loam or so, and a coarse sand. And the curve generally goes to some kind of residual water content. It's a kind of a contentious concept, this residual water content, because we know that eventually, because of film flow and vapor flow, this will go to zero, generally at about 10 to the 7th centimeters. Yeah. In a way to look upon this as the height above the water table. So H, in our case, will be negative in the unsaturated zone, positive in the saturated zone. Yeah. So these are the retention functions, so moisture characteristics. Some people use the capillary pressure saturation when you plotted versus saturation, the release curve. PF curve is a term that's often used in the soil hydrology literature here in Europe, where you actually plot this thing on a log scale. Well, it's done anyway. The functions are a function of subject to hysteresis. So we can have first drying curve, and then a wetting curve, and then a bunch of scanning curves. Most of the data in the literature are generally drying curves. And it's a little bit complicated. At the same time, it's important to not to overestimate the difficulties, because we generally know that the drying curve and the wetting curves are displaced by a factor of about 2, 1.8. Not necessarily always, but it is a good, if you have only the drying curve and you displace it by a factor of 2, for most systems it's pretty good. Yeah. Complete saturation here, or water content, actually you can make that a little bit more general, because if you start really at saturation, there actually also, like here with the residual water content, there can be residual air content. This is very often neglected, but we know in soils, even in the capillary fringe, that the porosity is generally too high for the saturated value. And some people near the capillary fringe or near the water table, they call sometimes this quasi-saturated. So even if it is completely saturated below the water table, it doesn't necessarily have to be complete saturation. And so you have primary drying curves and then the wetting curves, and they're all a little bit related to some reasonably approximate manner. This is the hydraulic conductivity, here again plotted versus water content, so a fine textured soil, a lower conductivity, it drops off, medium and coarse. Yeah. And you can also plot it, maybe it's sometimes a little easier to see versus the pressure head. So you have a coarse soil, the saturated conductivity is very high, it drops very quickly, a medium and a fine textured. Notice that I talk about coarse, medium, fine rather than necessarily clay, silt and sand. But it's really to some extent the same. Yeah. There are a number of equations for these functions. The most important one, or it's always been very popular, is the Brooks and Corey equation. They formulated that in 1964. I worked on it when I was a postdoc, and later on I'll show you the curves. There's a Kuzugi curves. These are very, very, in terms of the phenomenological properties, very similar to our equation. Yeah. So when you look at the Brooks and Corey, thought I had another one. Yeah, the Brooks and Corey function, HA here is known as the air entry value, but it's basically a power function. And then later, because this has to stop at the saturated water content, so this became known, we started attaching some physical significance to this, this became known as the air entry or bubbling pressure or something like that, HA. And then this became known as the pore size distribution index. So when we have a coarse soil, this is generally fairly large. And when we have a fine textured soil, it's much smaller. Yeah. I worked with this. I did a lot of numerics when I was a postdoc, and I worked with this, and what I noticed is that I had lots of trouble. I worked with the not the mixed form of the Richards equation, but the pressure head based equation. And there you have to have, in the numerical solution, you have to have the slope of the function. And this caused a lot of problems with me when I was doing the numerics. And so that was actually the reason I started looking at some alternative equations. And the one I came up with was really very much the same as Brooks and Corey, except I put a 1 in the bottom. And that lambda becomes the minus n in the next equation. So this goes to the bottom. If the 1 goes away, it's really Brooks and Corey. I put a 1 in there. And what it does is it makes this function much smoother here. So that's all I did, and initially I didn't pay too much attention, but it's being now used, and I probably wouldn't be here if I had not done that. Anyway. So here you can see one sandy soil, where you see typically the Brooks Corey may not work too well, and our function actually, when you look at especially relatively broad pore size distributions or particle size distributions, And field soils, also undisturbed systems, seems to be working a little bit better. Then we also have the equations for the hydraulic conductivity, and they are very much connected with the equations for the water retention function. Again, it's Brooks and Corey, our equations, and I'll show you in a minute how we get to that. The Kozugi functions, these are basically log normal distributions assumed of the particle pore size distribution, so with the complementary error function. Yeah. But the way that it was done was they were related. Let me go back here. So you had this function, these functions, and then you correlated that with what we call statistical pore size distribution models with the hydraulic conductivity. And that's schematically shown here. So we had the Laplace-Young's law basically to say what the capillary rise in a small tube is. And at any particular age, we then looked at which pores would be filled and which pores would be empty. And so this is the connection with actually the water content. Then in each of these capillaries, we would apply the Poiseuille's law for the hydraulic conductivity and then add them up. And then basically you come out then with the unsaturated hydraulic conductivity. There are many different models around, especially in petroleum engineering, in chemical engineering, in soils a little bit. The one I used is Mualem's. It came out just about when I was doing this for my postdoc. I started looking at this paper, and he claimed that it was better than some of the others. Many of the differences between these models is also how you account for heterogeneity among the capillary tubes. And one popular way is to actually visualize that you would cut these capillaries, you would twist it a little bit, and then put it back on the capillaries. And so there is a chance that a big pore would hit small pores and so on. And so we call this a cut and rejoin approach, which gives a difference in many of these equations. And then also, there is an additional fitting parameter in a way, what we call the tortuosity term, that also gives a different, gives differences between the various things. Yeah. So the one that we used was Mualem's model that's shown here. It looks complicated, it's really not that complicated. Actually, 1 over h is really proportional to the radius of a pore. So you can see that we integrate relative saturation here, the radius of the pore. So you get some kind of a water content there, and then manipulate this a little bit that goes to the conductivity. This is that tortuosity term. So there's a lot of flexibility here. Also, what that L value should be. Mualem suggested it 0.5. If you look at the Brooks and Corey model, they used Purcell's, no, what was it, Burdine's model. They don't have squares, and they have zero. They have a value of 2 for this index, but it gives a little bit more flexibility in fitting the data. Initially, we proposed in our equation independent values of m and n, which really is nice because it gives. And I'll show you that in the figure in a minute. But if you do that, and you solve for h SE here, and stick it in and do the integration, it becomes quite messy. You end up with incomplete beta functions. This is not, you know, people like to have a very nice little equation to work with. So, but that's why in our equations we use m is 1 minus 1 over n, and then it really simplifies quite quickly. There are other ways of simplifying it, becomes a little bit more complicated. So this is the simplest function, and this is probably the one that's mostly used. Yeah.
I always felt that was cheating. Well, you know, maybe n equals 1 over n doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, yeah.
For the actual.
No, that's true, and I'll show you the figure why it actually in a way it doesn't make sense. But if you have poor data, it works. If you have good data, it may not necessarily work too well. And I'll show you a picture, so you're completely right. Yeah. So the idea then is with these equations, you can fit your attention function, or the capillary pressure saturation relationship, and it's much more easier to determine, of course, than the unsaturated hydraulic conductivity. And so you use the same parameters. This is the complete Moalem. This LS 1.05 is purely predicted. And it's a relative function, so we still have to hang it up onto something to go to the saturated value. And generally, the saturated conductivity is probably one of the worst points to do that, because the saturated conductivity, you know, it's generally log normally distributed. And so soil structure and fractures and so in geological phenomena. So generally, if you have a point that you can measure away from saturation, would be a little bit better. But you know, for disturbed repacked systems, it works very well. And then here is actually these are some with some data. This is actually was done by Los Alamos National Lab. And it's very large crushed tuff samples. Let me see here. Let me go back to your question here, or your comment. It was, you know, when we have M and N independently, what happens is that this curvature here is independent of the curvature there. If we say M is 1 minus N, then this curvature is related in some fashion with the curvature at the lower end. So you can see that we have very little data that this actually helps to fix the curve. But in a way, it's being dishonest, that's right. So if you have very good data, so you can quickly see if we have very good independent data on the tailing side here, that we may get in trouble. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately in my case, most data that we have are fairly approximate. Yeah. Okay. So that's in terms of the unsaturated conductivity functions. A lot of ways of measuring these things, especially the challenge is the unsaturated hydraulic conductivity. So I'm not going to go through it very much. But the one that we are using, and if we have time, tomorrow or Friday, we'll do one of these inverse methods with the one-step multi-step approach. This one is pretty popular. We used to use that. Let me see here. Yeah, this is what we used a lot. So you have a small core, basically a suck out the moisture, so it's saturated, and you outflow versus time, and you do an inverse. This we call that sometimes a Tempi cell, a small little core about 5, 6, 7 centimeters long. Yeah. So this was popular in the States. We used that a lot. I think I have a picture of the setup, so it was completely automated and so on, but very slow. And one-step outflow works very well for very coarse soils. So if you put the one bar pressure on there, or you know, you can also press it out, it gives enough resolution to do the inverse. But generally, if you have a medium fine textured soil, we go to multi-step. Then we actually apply different steps, and then we look at the outflow, and then sometimes we also put the tensiometer in there, so you get more information, and then you can get estimates of the hydraulic properties. So I worked a lot with that in a laboratory where we were. Pete Charles was our experimentalist. He was very good in that. In Europe now, very popular, and I very much like the evaporation method. It has actually a long history in a more or less approximate way and so on. But more recently, these people here have been pushing what we call the HyProp system. It's a hydraulic property measurement system. And it's a very nice, I'm really sold on this now because it is also quasi automated. It goes much faster and so on. So there actually you have also a core, and then you put tensiometers in there. In this case, from below, you saturate it, and then you let it evaporate. And the conductivity is calculated by the difference. So it's linearized. It's kind of surprising, but it works quite well.
Okay.
Yeah?
I have one question. I was using this method, and during the evaporation, the structure of the soil can change because you can have cracks, etc. So what do you think about
That's right. If you have cracks and so on, it messes things up. And also, when you have very rocky media, it doesn't work very well. But we worked, with both disturbed and undisturbed soils, and it worked quite well. Yeah. The cracks, of course, if you have a lot of clay in there, and it depends on the clay type. Yeah. Yeah. And we did actually some tests with that. Let me see if I have it. Yeah, here, where we assumed hydraulic properties, we calculated, put in evaporation, potential evaporation, and then see what it goes. And so we have the potential the actual evaporation rate, which is really the weight, because I didn't say that, but this is being weighed. You look at the scale, so you can actually see how much evaporation goes out. Yeah. And so we did actually, I have to go the other way. So here we actually then assumed some hydraulic functions, hydraulic parameters. We calculate the evaporation rate and the tensiometers at 1/3 and 2/3 of the scale, and then did the inverse. And you can see it comes out very, very close. You know, the saturated water content was 0.5, and then this is two different optimizations. 0.008, that is 1 over the air entry value, 0.074, so pretty close. KS, it looks, and this was done actually assuming that KS is measured, and this was using KS also as a variable in the unknown parameter in the inverse. This looks like it's quite far away, but if you know that saturated conductivity, if you can measure that within 10 or 20%, you're pretty good. Yeah. Okay, and then this is another example. This is actually from a tropical soil. There's some data missing here where we use the HyProp data as well as the WP4, basically based on relative humidity. And there's a little software package that we use to fit, actually, when we have data, we can fit these various functions to it, including Kuzugi here, and also some dual porosity functions, like you can see here. There are many methods also in the field for measuring these things. I'm not going to go further into that. But the problem, of course, is that all these direct measurements are very time-consuming. The non-linearity, heterogeneity, so we can do a very good job at one point and go 5 centimeters away, and it may not necessarily work. So there are a lot of alternative methods available. The ones that we talked about here are these pore size distribution models. At least it gives a little bit of a direction to the hydraulic conductivity. particle size distribution, basically the shape similarity is another way of doing this. Poor network models. Sometimes when people ask me, if you had to do your career over again, what would you do? I probably would go on the bandwagon of poor skill models. And another area what I probably would work on would be root water uptake. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff being learned now to that. The more approximate way, but one that I believe very much in is the use of what we call Pitot transfer functions.
And I have a question.
Yeah.
If the soil heterogeneity is going to affect the direct measurement of the hydraulic conductivity curve, won't that be the same in the model if you assume there's one hydraulic conductivity when in reality it's very heterogeneous?
You have to repeat that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you have to average that in some way if you do the measurements, or if you take a sample, yeah, you make the rough approximation or assumption that it holds for a relatively large volume of soil. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, the idea is to obtain a mean, I guess.
Yeah. No, I think her point is that problem occurs whether you do direct measurement or indirect measurement.
Sure, yeah, yeah. No, it's completely true. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but the scales of the measurements are not the same.
Yes. What I was hoping him to say is that with indirect methods, it's much easier to characterize heterogeneity.
It's at least one hopeful manner. But many of the field methods of the hydraulic conductivity work with, as Dennis suggests, much larger scale. So if you have, for example, the drainage method, you know, unit gradient method or whatever it is, where you start with a saturated soil profile, you measure a bunch of pressure heads in the soil or water contents, and you look at how drainage, that will be an integrated, give integrated results for the whole profile. Okay, so then Pitot transfer functions, very important. And in the Hydrus code, we have two ways of dealing with that. So Pitot transfer function is really a way of correlating the hydraulic parameters with soil texture and other more easily measured data. This is some work that Carcel and Parrish did. They worked with the EPA, and they used a very, very large database of the US Department of Agriculture. So these are average values they got. And so there is a table in Hydrus that you can use. Don't believe necessarily, but at least it gives some direction. And another approach in Hydrus is the Rosetta model. That's from Marcel Sharp, I think, here. Yeah, Marcel Sharp did that with us, where you actually correlate not just with a textural class, but with more refined data. So in this case, percent sand-sealed clay. If you have a measure of the bulk density, you can include that. Or even sometimes you have measurements of field capacity. The old value would be at 330 centimeters, or the wilting point. So you can also put that in there here, and then you get estimates of your hydraulic properties. This is what we call Rosetta Light, so we get these values, the Rosetta full software also gives you some uncertainty around it. So I'll show you that later when we do the exercises. Yeah. Of course, when we work with the flow equation, we have to use boundary conditions, how it interacts with the outside environment. We have both system-independent boundary conditions, so the pressure that is given, let's say ponding, where the flux is given as a function of time at the surface. You know, it could be rainfall or irrigation or whatever it is. Gradient conditions, generally we use this at the bottom of a profile, so where the flux becomes equal to the hydraulic conductivity. But we also have a large number of system-dependent boundary conditions where the soil gives feedback to what the actual value will be. Yeah? For example, here, when you have a very high precipitation rate, and the hydraulic conductivity is one half here, 25. Initially, the soil may be very dry, it absorbs all the water, but there will be a point where it becomes saturated. The soil cannot absorb everything. And so then the infiltration rate goes down, and then it depends a little bit how you're gonna, what you're gonna do with the ponded water. You can let it run off immediately, you get this line, or you can have it built on the soil profile. And then, of course, there is a building, the infiltration rate still be still a little higher than the conductivity. And then here is the pressure head. So it will be very small. It goes to very negative, goes to zero. If you have runoff immediately and the rain stops, it starts drying. If there is ponding, you have a little bit more water still, and it infiltration proceeds a little longer. And the same really happens also with evaporation, where you have stage one. You know, when the soil is very wet, your potential evaporation rate can be maintained. There will be a point where it's going to go down. Then there are other system-dependent boundary conditions. The most common one is a seepage phase. Remember the classical thing where you have water at one side of a dike, and it goes through the dike, and it goes out here. When it gets to saturation, then the pressure head becomes zero. That's here. And you can calculate the flux given the distributions inside the dike. When it's unsaturated, then the flux becomes zero. Another other examples here are tile drains in agriculture, or even a soil column. If you have a soil column in the laboratory and you have just a filter at the bottom, and you start infiltrating, the water goes down, it will be unsaturated, the flux will be zero. When it becomes saturated, it starts dripping. And then the boundary condition becomes zero, the pressure head. Yeah. Very important in all these simulations is root water uptake. I can easily talk for an hour on that, but the way that's being done is one, you know, there are quite a few different approaches. The one that we use is by a fellow called Feddes. He was from the Agriculture University in Wageningen at the time, both 2D. In 1D, what we do is basically calculate the potential transpiration rate. You can use Penemontese, there's hard grease, there are a number of approaches. And then we distribute it, let me just do the 1D here, we distribute it over the root zone, which can be have any form as you want. When the soil dries out, the potential rate cannot be maintained, and so the actual transpiration rate becomes smaller than the potential rate. Yeah. And that's shown here schematically. Oops. Yeah. With this function, actually, this is the Feddes approach, where you say that the uptake of water by plant roots is basically maximum until some value where it goes down to here the wilting point. Yeah. And it depends a little bit on the potential evapotranspiration rate, or potential rate, transpiration rate. If you have a very high transpiration rate, think about a dry, hot climate. We know that it will go down much quicker. The soil really cannot deliver. So there's a limitation there that there are really no soil parameters in there. And when it's a very slow evaporation rate, the soil can keep delivering the water according to the potential rate. Yeah. And then also here is a division here where we say that sometimes there is an aerobic, anaerobic factor, you know, that the plants don't take up necessarily when it's saturated. I'm not a complete believer in that during normal conditions, but of course a lot of roots don't grow in the groundwater, so this is really important also.
Really?
Yeah.
With respect to the unsatisfied demand, when you have the drying at the surface, do you allow the model to transfer that demand to where there is available water, or is it that 30% of the water will be coming from the upper surface, and if it's not satisfied, you'll simply have a deficit of 30% in the water?
In terms of uptake?
Yes.
Yeah, no, I actually, we have what we call compensated uptake. Yep. So we can our plans here. This is actually very, very nice question. Plans are very smart. And so when we do the classical approach, we say that the uptake rate at any point diminishes along this function. But plans somehow have an ability to start compensating the uptake from other parts, and they start uptaking more than what the potential rate is. And this, right? This is what you mean, yeah. So that's included a mechanism in Hydrus. Is it perfect? No. I'm you know, if you start really hard looking at it, but that's at least one way of accounting for that. Yeah. It's the stuff that Jarvis did in Sweden. There are another way of accounting for that. That's why we worked at the salinity lab. We actually now this is plotted now the other way, where actually we use a smooth function. We don't have that anaerobic or the saturated part here, and then we actually used salinity threshold salinity response functions to get also some estimates of these various parameters. This is just basically a smooth function here, where HP is then the H50 is where the uptake becomes 1/2. So we could really catalog very well the various crops. And then also here is, you know, we have water stress and solute stress. So we did this solute stress, we used that as a proxy for water stress by just converting. Basically they're additive. We know they're additive at the small scale. But unfortunately, soils, water stress is less buffered than solutes. And so there is a much quicker response for water stress at the microscopic level by the roots. And so you can add then water and solute stress, or we can actually make it multiplicative and not really connect that. And then based on a large number of data sets, we think that this P should be about 3. Yeah. So, but this is included, and you can have at least some options within the code. Yeah. And then here you see how it goes. So if you have excellent potential uptake, and then because the soil dries out, you have your uptake, but then also compensated. That means that this line is going to be a little bit bigger. And this is also done later with passive, active, and no uptake of solutes. We always say that there is no uptake of solutes. No, we do have uptake of solutes, and I think there's a little bit of rethinking that actually a lot of the solute is being taken up passively. Active uptake is, of course, when you think about vegetation in terms of phyto extraction, phyto remediation.
Also nutrients. Nutrients also.
Yeah, okay. Okay, and then root growth, if you're interested in seasonal things. Yeah. Then if we go to solute transport, I think we're going to speed up a little bit. No, we still have a little. So the governing equation here, again, 1D. In Hydrus, there are many different options. We can have actually single ion transport. Think about just chloride or any particular, you know, heavy metal or so on, where you simulate that as a single ion. We also do that with colloids and bacteria. So the governing equation is slightly modified, but that's a single ion. Then we have decay chains. We can include that. That's the standard Hydrus model, where you have actually, you know, nitrification, denitrification chain, radionuclides here, pesticides. Sometimes the daughter products are more dangerous than the mother product, so we have that in there. This is a exercise I would like to do, probably not this afternoon or this morning yet, but maybe tomorrow we look at a hydrocarbon decay chain, PCE, TCE, DCE, phenyl chloride here, and ethylene if we have time, and a number of other things. Then in Hydrus also, there are a number of modules. One is the UNSET chem model that looks at major ion chemistry, including pH dynamics. So think about calcite, gypsum, and a number of other things, major cations, chloride, sulfate, and so on. A more refined approach, and this is hardwired in the code, so you can do that with the unset chem approach. We also have an approach where we coupled geochemistry with the hydrus. This is HP1, so this is actually from hydrus and freak C we coupled. It's a non-iterative sequential approach. So we do water flow, freak C, and that keeps going. And it's especially done here. This is Jurke Simonek. Diederik Jacques from the Belgium Nuclear Research Center. He has been working with us for a long time on this. We also have constructed wetlands symposium. This module, this is in 2D, where you look a lot at the organic and other reactions. And then also we have a module there where we look at colloid facilitated transport. But we're not going to go into that with the...
In your model, the bacteria, do you treat them like inert particles, or are they, like, can they swim? Like, how do you treat the bacteria in your model?
The bacteria, if it's just a single ion, you know, we have filtration and adsorption, including, if needed, at the air-water interface. But this is where you have colloid transport, and then the solutes will be hooked onto the colloid moving. Is this what you mean?
No, I want to think to account that the bacteria can swim like in other directions.
Oh, upward. You know, active, no, we don't have that. It's a passive transport, yeah. Only by diffusion against the flow direction, no. So this is in the standard. This is what you will be working with later. This is the standard sequential first order decay. So it's fairly straightforward. We have a mother product, a daughter product, and we have degradation from the mother to the daughter, as well as you can go outside. So one example of the outside would be, for example, ammonium. So it would go to nitrate, but it can also go into the air. Yeah. It can be volatile. Yeah. There's a lot of bookkeeping here, but the basic system is pretty well defined. And then also boundary conditions, of course. The natural boundary condition to use, I'll make some remarks with Stanmott a little bit about that, but this is the natural boundary condition to use. This is really not a good one, where you say that the concentration at the inlet is given, because you get actually then too much solute in your system. And this is actually quite important for small-scale experiments. And then also gradient conditions. You know, this is fairly standard theory for the dispersion coefficient. Of course, we have the longitudinal dispersivity, I call it here lambda, and a diffusion term. And then 2, 3D. Along the lines of Bayer. Don't spend too much time on it, and how the dispersivity. This is actually quite important to give some direction of what the dispersivity should be, the longitudinal dispersivity. So it's about 1/10 of the scale. A number of people worked on that. This is, I think, from Galhar, Mary Anderson, Bill Jury, and others. So about 1/10 of the scale, if you have a reasonably homogeneous system, it can be a little bit lower. So if you have a small column in the laboratory, it's in the order of a few centimeters. When you go to the field, it's much higher.
Reed, on that point, would you care to, the fundamental grid scale is where your dispersivity, your dispersion coefficient should be focused, and then you represent explicitly the dispersive processes thereof. And so does this plot really relate, or is it simply a matter of the user's responsibility to put in the heterogeneity to obtain the correct dispersion?
Yeah, no, we just give some guidance.
Okay.
We just say, you know, if you do a field profile that is 2 meters and you don't know what it is, use 20 centimeters. And that really holds for the bottom. If you're interested in closer to the surface, you actually may want to use a little bit smaller value. Because this is really the total transport domain. And so it's really at the end. Okay. 5 minutes, okay. So I'll run a little, we're doing fine. Then sorption, there's a lot of sorption in there. The simple case of a linear sorption, you get a retardation factor. But in reality, there are many different approaches possible. The one that we use is a combined Freundlich-Langmuir isotherm. So you can see when this beta is 1, you get the Langmuir. When this eta is 0, you get the Freundlich. And when this is 1 and 0, then you have a linear isotherm. So this covers. Yeah, this is adsorption and concentration. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Then we have a number of non-equilibrium approaches. The simplest one would be, a chemical non-equilibrium, where you can have one-side sorption or two-side sorption. The way we have it done, modeled, is basically as a two-side sorption model. So we have an equilibrium fraction and a kinetic fraction. So the equilibrium would be S is KC, KDC, so equilibrium. And this would be kinetic along the lines of this equation. So when F is 1, everything is equilibrium. And when F is 0, everything becomes one-side non-equilibrium. So this is done. The one-side models generally, as our experience, don't improve a whole lot on the equilibrium. So you have to have a little bit more flexibility to go to two-side models. Yeah. We have colloids and colloid-facilitated transport. That's also in part in the module that you described. But so yeah, you can have colloids moving, you can have attachment, detachment, you can have straining, filtration, you can say, and then you can also have adsorption on the air-water interface. So, and that's modeled here. It's an extra term, so some of this kinetic and some of this is straining, and there are some other parameters. Yeah. And then physical non-equilibrium. This is a slide I got from I think Marcus Tuller. I think Danny, you might be familiar with that one too. But this is really non-equilibrium. We call it physical non-equilibrium, or related to fractured rock of structured soils and so on. Can you see water moving through these large pores? And so you can have transport and then, and of course, diffusion into the matrix. And then this is the kind of the thing I like. You have water can be unsaturated in the large pores while still being fairly saturated in the intra-aggregate pores and inter in between pores. And the way this is modeled in hydrus is where we actually use a transfer term, basically first order driving force. And you can actually relate these very much to structural parameters, so as the size of your matrix or aggregates and the diffusion coefficient, but in reality it's generally pretty much empirical. But when we use that, at least, this is a breakthrough curve when we use the advection dispersion equation. This is a pesticide, doesn't work very well. And so when we use this physical non-equilibrium, we can at least get a reasonable description. Then we also have volatilization, so think about the partitioning into the gas phase, basically Henry's law. Yeah, so you can work that out. I'm not going to further do that. A lot of these coefficients, and I think Jesus mentioned that, are very much a function of temperature. And the general equation we use is the Arrhenius equation. So you think about the diffusion, distribution, and so on. So there's an option in hydrus if you want to account for these temperature dependencies. And in that sense, we also have heat transport in there. And I'm not going to go really deep into that, but the basic equation is very much the same as the transport equation. So water capacities, the heat capacities, the conductivities, and so on. And then the last thing is we have a lot of effort done in making this a nice tool for analyzing observed data. So we have parameter estimation. The way we do it is with a Market Leuvenberg, so it's not the global optimization. But this works much faster, and generally we're reasonably... 1 minute and I'm done, yeah. And you can do, you know, do the inverse with hydraulic parameters, reaction, this and that, and in different ways. Yeah. And then there's three terms. This is basically minimizing state variables. Think about concentration, temperature, this and that, fluxes. If you have some additional information, you can put it in, and then also you can constrain it a little bit. This is your area. Jesus, I should let you explain this. In StanMod, we just minimize difference between observed and calculated concentrations, where then D, this is a vector of the unknown, so it can be velocity, dispersion coefficients, some degradation coefficients. And then the last thing here is basically my last slide. We spend a lot of time on the graphical interfaces. So this is the domain of Merak-Saina. So I spend a lot of time, especially in 2D, to make it user-friendly. So this is a dike, capillary barrier here, and the flux. This is actually an exercise we do in the Hydrus 2D short courses. Yeah. This is a system where we had actually a break in a holding point for very radioactive materials. Oops, I need to go back. And so we did some simulations where actually it goes down here through the unsaturated zone, the saturated zone you can see here. And surprisingly, a lot of material ended up in the capillary fringe area. And then this is also actually a small simulation where we use the Richards equation and transport for a ink droplet infiltration. And so this is in the order of micrometers. Yeah. And so it's very small. We use the continuum larger scale approach where the pore scale was used to get the hydraulic properties. Margaret Livenberg is based on what you do is you calculate, let's say maybe that you have a Margaret Livenberg is a gradient method.
Niklas?
Ah, yeah, super.
You will discuss that in detail tomorrow, no?
I will not, but...
Never mind.
All right. Well. Let me preempt you a little bit, but you know, I'm not overly an expert in that necessarily. But what we want to do is we want to minimize the objective function. In our case, basically the sum of squared differences between observed and calculated values, and then you can have different parameters or different variables, you know, water condensed and pressure heads and so a little bit. Anyway, so if you have this, this would be a certain parameter. Maybe let's say Ks, or let me do the dispersivity dL. And so what the gradient method is actually the easiest way would be, so you start out with some initial estimate, you change the value a little bit, and you calculate the gradient, and you go down to the lower value. So you can see that when you start going here, you go back, so you go to the minimum. The danger of the gradient methods is that sometimes you have local minima. How does that go? So if you not careful enough, it may actually converge to a local minimum and not the global minimum. And this is especially true when you have lots of variability in your data. It's not overly well defined. With StanMod generally, we have no problem. A lot of the problems inverse, with Hydrus also nothing. But when we start combining, let's say, hydraulic conductivity, pressure heads, concentrations, there becomes more difficult. And so then people basically go to a global, where there's somehow, and Jesus can explain that probably better, but you really look at all of the set of parameter values and then go to some way to the minimum. Good enough? Okay? So this, so because this is, you know, if you do this, it may be 10 or 100 times computationally much longer. much more intense. We have, and I mentioned that, well, we did it for solute. That's also, and we talk about that this afternoon, but you can also do that with water flow. So you can have dual porosity and dual permeability. Our recommendation, not necessarily to go too quickly to dual permeability, but we like dual porosity. There are a number of different approaches that you can use in hydrous. Yeah. Yeah. That's exactly physical non-equilibrium. So I did that with the solute, but we can do that the same. We do actually very much the same for water flow, and we also have like in dual porosity, we have just basically dual porosity functions. In dual permeability, we have two Richards equations, and you can have it imbibe in some way. As a function of either saturation differences or pressure differences.
But, sorry, this is an invention of him. He's very humble. He has invented many things, and I think I admire you more for that model than for the money.
Okay.
For the retention curve. No, seriously. No. Even though the retention curve is a lot more serious than he presented here, I mean, the paper is very inspiring. It's not just, I did it so. Fuck you. But I think this model is beautiful and it's excellent for soil and blah, blah, blah. Why did you say, oh, don't jump to the other? I said, well, this is the soil.
No, I actually would agree. When I look back of what I did, I'm more proud of the non-equilibrium solid transport. That's what my PhD was about, and then we published that also later with Horst Gerke, one of the postdocs that came to Riverside, where we looked at dual porosity, dual permeability for water flow, because that's a struggle. So there is really a hierarchy of models that we use, one with where we just force basically the conductivity to go up very quickly near saturation, but we still use the Richards equation. Then we have the Richards equation with a sink term, just one Richards equation, so it's kind of a dual porosity indirect in a way, and then we have the dual permeability. But the problem is the dual permeability approach is you better know what you're doing, because it becomes numerically very quickly unstable. So I'm not a big, even though we publish these papers, but I'm not necessarily a big fan of going to dual permeability immediately. In fact, I get a lot of questions. People start looking at heterogeneity, going back a little bit to that. But they're not necessarily seasoned modelers, whatever that means. But so they come up with a model, they include water flow, so you transport, root water uptake, dual permeability, and the model doesn't work. So your model is not worth anything. What's the problem? Well, sorry, there are about 20 different ways that it can go wrong. So, these things are not easy necessarily. Okay.
I have a pot for plants, which is plastic, and you can see the plants and the water.
Yeah.
When you put the water, you can see the water going down one way, and then it goes up another way by capillarity. This is my friend Magnus model, and that now they're saying, oh, don't use it. You need that. I mean, if you want to see that the water goes that way, goes down one way and up another, the best way to represent that is your mother. I am disappointed they say, no, be careful.
No, there's a lot of stuff. Actually, when you apply this, I don't know, it's not necessarily the same, but you apply this, for example, to a wall or you have stone and it evaporates and it can go very quickly into the fractures or where the cement is and then very slowly go out of your stone. And so you have a lot of degradation of monuments that are quite interesting. I know, Danny, you worked on that also a little bit. But there's a lot of stuff. And you can actually do that with hydrus. Or with Danny's model, whatever, you know, a little bit. He will be talking about some of these things, right, later. It's very interesting. Oh, you do? Slightly different, okay, okay.
So we have time for one last question.
All right.
No?
I have already, no one
else. There's a lady there, yeah.
The liquid and the solid phase, what do you mean?
Interaction by chemical processes or products and the precipitation or the solution.
Yeah.
Your adsorption.
But we can talk about this.
Yeah. She's talking about the liquid, the solid interaction.
Ah, so some chemical reaction of the liquid and the solid. Not really. You know, we assume that you always have a little bit of a film and.
Friction.
Ah, the chemistry in general. Okay, yeah. So we there was this one slide where I showed the in a hierarchy of different approaches where we have just single ion transport, we have the decay chains, and then we have the Freeksy hydrous combination. So
it's
Yeah, there's also a feedback, but that's in Freeksy, not in the hydrous, where ionic strength and distribution or composition has an effect on the hydraulic properties. Yeah. And you can change the hydraulic properties accordingly in the model. But that's in Freeksy, not in the standard hydrous. Yeah. Right, is this what you asked?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.